First item on our agenda is a public hearing for a proposed salary administration plan bylaw amendment.
Move that the segment open the public hearing.
Second.
Moved and seconded to open the public hearing. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstain, 5-0-0.
So, Mr. Chair and members of the selectmen, this is the annual public hearing to consider an amendment to the classification and wage schedule of the salary administration plan bylaw. We did bring a proposal up a couple weeks ago to the selectmen and suggesting that in a couple cases, or many cases, our positions in Section A, particularly of the salary administration plan bylaw, were behind in terms of average salary ranges out there for similar positions. And after some discussion, the selectmen did agree that for draft purposes, we would draft a wage schedule that would increase 6% plus 2% at the minimum for a total of 8%, and 3.5% plus 2% at the maximum, so 5.5% total. So that's what you have before you tonight in general, and also Human Resources Management Analyst Bueller is here. She is able to go over any of the changes that she would like to know otherwise with respect to the proposed bylaw amendment that's before you.
Okay. And so just to clarify, we're talking about changing the ranges that are in the plan itself. It has nothing to do with the actual salaries paid to existing
Right.
staff. It's simply setting the stage for all the positions across town government. And some of the proposals that are in here also are the typical annual increases based on bargaining unit contracts going forward for the next fiscal year. It's kind of a combination.
Yeah.
Okay.
So in the memo that Sarah has prepared out, mm-hmm. Outlines all the changes. I don't know if you'd like her to go over them with you.
Well, maybe you could do a quick run through.
So in the attached bylaw, all the changes are highlighted in yellow for you to control along that way. But as noted in the memo, category A not only reflects the changes to the minimums and maximums as readers are described, but it also includes a few changes to a few positions throughout the bylaw. The assistant town manager position has been reclassified from an M17 to an M20. The building and systems superintendent position has been reclassified from an M12 to an M13 position. The animal control officer was reclassified from an M9 to an M12 position, which was partially as a result of the intermunicipal agreement that was signed with the town of Lexington to share that position. And then finally, in the M11 grade, you'll notice that the health leave effort coordinator position was added to that as well. Throughout the rest of the categories specific to the collective bargaining units, you will again see the current or the upcoming contract rates that will be coming up. You'll also notice from last year, the public health category has been removed entirely from the bylaw. As a result from the school nurse positions being transferred to the school department budget in FY16. Finally, in category H, which is the recreation category, you'll notice several changes. In particular, Missy noticed the midpoints have been highlighted. Those have been adjusted to reflect the true midpoint between the minimum and the maximum that had been established previously. It's just those midpoints have never been adjusted to reflect the true midpoint. Also under the school age child care program, the group leader maximum was increased in that position by 2%. The minimum and midpoint of those positions were both increased last year by 2.25. The last time the maximum was increased was in FY14. Following down the line, Springsbrook Park program, all levels A through E for the crew 3 and crew 2 positions, those have all been increased by 40 cents. For the crew 1 position, which is that entry level position where kids would typically start, levels A through C have been increased by 30 cents. Level D and E are both increased by 40 cents. And then finally, under the summer adventures slash summer recreation programs category, the range of the program leader position has been changed to the same rates that the program instructor position has been established under the instructional program section. These two positions really serve the same function. They are providing similar type programs, just at different points during the year. Specifically, the program leader position, those are giving those programs during the summer months. So that change would actually result in a decrease to the minimum to $15, an increase to the midpoint to $22.50, and then the maximum is increased to $30. Then finally, in that section of the age category, counselor, high school grad, counselor, high school age, and the aid positions, all levels have been increased by 50 cents.
Okay, very good. Questions or comments? Bill?
A couple questions around the same issue. The ones that you changed categories upward, those were selected because?
So the assistant town manager and the building system superintendent specifically, those were updated through a review of the classification. We look at responsibilities of the position, the education, the experience level that we would want someone to have in those positions. And after review of those two positions, it was decided that we should be increasing the grade. Animal control officer, again, that was more of a result of the intermunicipal agreement that we agreed to pay a certain rate of pay with the town of Lexington. And then the healthy Bedford coordinator position, you might remember, funding was approved during the last fiscal year to basically put that into the bylaw, and that's the rate that it was paid at previously.
So when the, thank you for the information. Mm-hmm. So when the selectmen were looking at these, both in terms of being out of line high or out of line low, a couple that were particularly low was in the M11 category for assistant accountant and assistant treasurer collector, and those were significantly out of line, and I didn't know whether that was because we have a very different use for those people than other towns that we're being compared to, and I didn't know whether you had looked at that now or whether the intent was to look at these later.
It is the intent to look at them later as part of a review of all of the salary administration plan, wage and classification schedule. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from members? Any questions or comments from the public? Seeing none.
Move that the public hearing be closed.
Second.
Moved and seconded to close the public hearing. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, abstain, 5-0-0.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before you leave, I didn't really think it was part of the hearing process, mm-hmm. but I do note that the salary survey that we use and are compared to is, 18 years old? And I mean, looking at this last sheet, and I do know these came from the MMA, I think. That's what.
Well, MMA is not the same as MMA Consulting Group. Hmm.
Okay.
Separate.
Right.
Organization similar in name.
In any case, this data is available, I would assume, relatively easily currently, I'm wondering whether, even though maybe we don't have some outside organization providing this, whether before we do this again probably a year from now, we might figure out a way to get more current.
We will do this as part of the study that we're going
right.
to.
Oh, perfect.
My impression is that this list is here so that we knew the comparable communities.
Yes, that's true.
It was the basis.
They may not be comparable anymore.
Right. No, you're right. It would have to be updated, but that, I didn't put much stock in, you're right. That
I
information
didn't,
is...
I did not either.
Okay. All right.
But I did note how old the data was.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Our next item is our next set of discussions about the fiscal year 17 operating budget. We have updated sheets and we have an updated overall summary page. Rick, did you want to talk about this to start with?
So last week, you looked at the budget as submitted by the departments, and tonight, what I am presenting to you is the budgets as submitted by the departments and as recommended by the town manager. There are really two significant, overall, I should say, that the recommended budget is set to increase 3.4% over the non-fixed portion of selectmen's budgets last year. So the finance committee's guideline would have had the budget increase like 2.5%. So the difference between the 2.5% and the 3.4% is really attributable to two items which have already been discussed with the selectmen. The first one is a proposal to run a pilot program for the expansion of local transit services. That is shown in the budget before you tonight as being funded in the BLT budget, and that brings the overall budget up to $166,235. About $104,000 of that is related to the pilot program of that we're planning to run. And it's been divided in the BLT budget into one main part, which is contracted services, and a small section for salary, I think at $4,100. And our intention would be to have one of our part-time staff members work on administering the pilot program throughout its term, and then if it turns out we do not continue with the pilot program, we would reduce the part-time hours of that person who's be working on that. And then the other item is $35,000 in the finance department budget for IT services, and these are consulting services that we would like to provide for in the budgeting, in the adopted budget of the finance department. We find that we really need some funding for sourcing, outsourcing some consulting services for the more challenging and more complex technical needs that we are experiencing every day nowadays. I think we had a summary of how we were going to use those funds, right, Victor?
Yes, we did.
Did you want to talk about those just a little bit?
Sure.
Just go over the summary of the IT funds. I think the selectmen have heard less about that than the BLT.
Sure. We talked about it fairly briefly last week.
Let me just pull that up. The money would be used to install an upgraded management system to configure the software that manages updates on desktop computers throughout the town, where we have to individually go to each computer and do the updates, and this would allow centralized updates to be done and to be able to do them through the IT department. Implement network monitoring to monitor the network. This will include intrusion detection, unusual activity, and system availability. Configure, a lot of this is IT, so forgive me, I'm not as vast on IT as my IT person. Implementation and configuration of network infrastructure. This would be able to increase our networking, switches, and our servers that we use throughout the town, and that we also communicate with the schools. And then also configure the storage array. I don't, 2 years ago, I don't know if you recall, we had a storage array failure. So our thought process is to bring in a second storage array that would be used to replicate data. So if we ever did have a failure again, we would have a backup and we wouldn't be down like we were in the past and possibly lose data. And also configure our Active Directory environment. to go to the cloud also for our email server. These are the various things. Also, we're dealing with technical issues that are occurring in the fire department in regards to PAMET and having to communicate while the ambulance is on the field and be able to transmit data to the various hospitals when our patients are being transported. And there's been some failures in that, and trying to fix those failures and have better communication back and forth with the various hospitals that we deal with.
So are these primarily software products?
These are services to accomplish items that were just described. Essentially, it's not buying new things, it's getting the time of a person to assist with these activities.
So we have the like, we already get money set aside for the array, so we can, this would be able to purchase, like Greg said, services, especially on services, where we feel that we need throughout the town. Right now, with the increase in IT, we find that, you know, IT department is good at what they do, but there's some specialty services that they need contracting to help them assist them in their daily work. And we're limited from the funds that we have in the department to be able to do that.
Altogether, these services are budgeted for 300 hours of yes. services.
And again, we will evaluate this in fiscal year 17 and come back to you in fiscal year 18 to determine whether, you know, it was enough money to be able to handle the additional increase in IT services that we need, or do we need more funds, or do we need less funds? So.
Mm-hmm. Other questions about those two items?
Yeah. The timing. So the timing for everything that you just said and the money spent is within a fiscal year? Is
Yes. These are representative of the types of things that the IT staff are needing, but they can't get to.
Can't get to.
Don't have the time to get to.
And, yeah. Or the training and the special.
Exactly.
Specialty.
Sure. I mean, especially the training, especially in the fire department. Mm-hmm. With regards to the PAMET service.
You just rattled off a long list of things and just...
Yeah, this is, we're not planning on finishing this in July.
Right. Okay. Good, so it's good stuff.
The year, fiscal year.
So these are, can these be described in some cases as be safety issues?
Well,
I mean, like for the fire department?
Well, the fire department would be safety issues, definitely. If they're not able to communicate with the hospitals, there's definitely an issue with that. And be able to get the information in there timely, and also
the loss of data.
Exactly, and mm-hmm. also for billing purposes too. Get the information over to our billing.
So there's some income benefits to this, and
yes.
From the fire department point of view, and the stuff that's mostly in your office is mostly for security of data in case of failure.
Security of data, updated data. I mean, right now we're using Microsoft 2003. For our email server, so we need to update that to the most latest and greatest data. So I mean, we are on 2003 for office right now. I mean, excuse me, email, not for office, but email.
And there has to be a kind of a soft cost savings in not going out and touching every computer that you need to update with, you know, that kind of service that you're able to push out the updates.
Exactly.
And centralize that. Somebody right now is actually going out and doing those updates.
Right.
So there's some hours that could be saved with
mm-hmm.
that too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, our IT department not just deals with the computers, but they deal with, like I said, the fire department, the police department,
mm-hmm.
the dispatch center. They're dealing with issues over there and the communication of the dispatch center. So it's crucial that we have the ability to use IT consultant services to evaluate and troubleshoot issues that occur at times of need.
We also feel that it's best to have this funding established as consulting services rather than try to request additional personnel,
right.
Because we want to have the flexibility to go to the particular expertise that we might need for the
mm-hmm.
task at hand. And it's difficult to get one person that knows all of these things
mm-hmm.
or specializes in all of these.
Mm-hmm.
Probably impossible.
As I indicated, there are several communities out there that do similar things. They have IT people that are in-house that they can sell for expertise services. So otherwise, you'd be hiring five IT people to do various different things
mm-hmm.
in the town for their expertise.
Or you'd be asking to hire five
IT
people. Are there Any other questions about, I know we started down a path of asking questions about individual budget line items. I just wanted to check if we're all done asking about the IT request for services and the pilot transportation initiative.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, about transportation?
Sure.
I went to the finance committee, not selectmen's meeting, the finance committee meeting, and I got some informal pushback about that transportation issue. And part of it was I'd like to revisit why it is that we are considering doing this at all. Intellectually, I understand how the BLT service stops at around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I understand that that there are people who need public or at least jitney-type service after that. But the question I was asked specifically is, what evidence do you have that there's any demand for this? And I said back to them, well, this is a pilot program to find out. And they said back to me, $104,000 to find out if there's any demand for $104,000 of service. So we ought to talk about that for a minute. And then last year, you may recall that we went over what was the recommended budget, and the finance committee said we don't think that that's appropriate to spend that much money above what we're recommending. What account would you like it taken out of? And we didn't have a recommendation, and so on their own, the finance committee took whatever amount of money it was out of
recreation.
And I know that finance doesn't like to do that. So they're looking at us to say, well, if we don't want to approve $104,000 to do this, where would you like to find the money? Now, maybe the money will be there and maybe they will agree that this should be done. So I think we ought to be clear about why we want to do this, and then we ought to talk about what if they say no and what do we want to do? So here's our chance.
I'd be happy to address the why question.
Sure.
You have to go back to 2014 when we did the National Citizens Survey, updated every 4 years, and we asked a transportation question as one of our optional add-on questions so that we could get some statistically significant respondents about the issues having to do with transportation. I believe, off the top of my head, that 72% of respondents were either strongly interested in or somewhat interested in expanded circulator. Mm-hmm. There was another option to ask for commuter, which would be a different animal, and that there was also very strong, above 75% of respondents responded strongly to that as well. In the course of the CHNA grants that Carla Olson, Healthy Bedford coordinator, was working on over the course of several years, there was a lot of informal surveying that was done, survey monkey sort of things that were not as quite as quantifiable as the National Citizen Survey, which is done scientifically. And there was a lot of interest expressed in increased hours for the BLT, increased access to the BLT, because the way it's structured now, although it works very well for the people who are able to access it, there are people who would like to be able to take it who can't because it's at capacity because of the nature of the service that it's providing. So taken together, along with a lot of the work that's being done out of Healthy Bedford and Safe Routes to School, a lot of the concerns about our 3 p.m. rush hour, where we have a lot of school-related transports going on, our air quality issues, our interest in improving mobility for people beyond just the seniors. That was really the motivation for coming forward with the pilot proposal at this point. Another important aspect of it, when you ask the question of why spend $100,000 to find out if there's demand, and it's true, although we have the interest, we don't know, we cannot quantify the demand because it's an unmet demand at this point. We're essentially creating something that has not existed in the past. we could take that $100,000 and we could spend it on a transportation consultant to tell us whether or not there was a demand and have a study at the end and not have implemented anything. The way that we draft the RFP will help us maximize the value of that money in terms of data collection so that in 9 or 18 months, we can be much farther ahead in our understanding of what the demand is based on the ability of the transportation firm that we hire to collect the data not only on the trips that they take, but the trips that they couldn't take, the trips that people wanted to take, the origins and the destinations of all of the trips. They can mm-hmm. map those for us. Mm-hmm. So ultimately, as far as I'm concerned, the value of that $100,000 goes beyond the value of the service that it provides to the people who take the bus from point A to point B. I think it will have an important impact on our being able to quantify just that question, to answer that question in much more in a much more data-driven sort of way.
I had forgotten about the survey, and you're quite correct. That's what I remember.
And I'll just add one point. When the economic development coordinator was in front of us talking about speaking to local businesses who would like this service, so this was also voiced in informal conversations with local businesses, and mm-hmm. So that brought on something new that came on after the survey, but was, you know, something that was a valid point of a need.
So that brings us to the issue of how to pay for it, whether there are any other place that money could come from. I have to tell you, nothing jumped out at me as I read these things. I don't know if anybody has any thoughts about that. Again, finance hasn't said anything really formally about this, so they might. They might say yes, and they might say no.
Mm-hmm.
Are we, let's put it this way, are we driven to the point that that if they absolutely are against it, that we would want to go to the mattresses, go down fighting about it? Or is this something we'd be willing to step back from if a push came to shove?
Well, I mean, it also begs the question whether we would simply propose it as a separate activity. I mean, it doesn't have to be embedded in the budget. I mean, if that's what happens sometimes. If we can't agree on what should be in the basic operating budget, then there are times when there are requests to spend money. Finance still gets to weigh in, but...
Let
town meeting decide. And then we would have to be able to present the same level of information and be able to say to town meeting, we think this is a good idea, and town meeting can ultimately decide.
When does the warrant go to press?
February 16th.
I mean, we'll be in front of finance. We'll be able to have this conversation, be able to describe what we just described, and they'll have to decide whether or not they feel there's room for it in the budgeting process. If not, then you're right. We'll have to figure out either we want to make room for it, but I don't see where there's room.
I'm just preparing.
Exactly. You're not advocating either way. And I'm just saying, and you said, so what are the options? So,
yep. I mean, one of the options is what town meeting was.
One of the options is to just run it as an article on its own, an independent request for funds, as another department, I think, is asking to do. So I don't know if anybody had any other ideas or whether anybody has ideas about something in the budget that you think we would rather do this than something that's in the budget now. But I'm somewhat hesitant to have asked all the departments to go through the exercise that we ask them to do annually and then say, oh, by the way, we've decided that part of your budget isn't as important to us as it is to you, even though you've done that process and you've stayed within the guidelines the way you were asked to. I mean, it's a pilot. It's an add-on pilot. So either we can make the case and say within the budget process, this add-on pilot is something everybody wants to try, or
yep.
we have to take it a different way.
Did you want to say something, Mike?
Not about this.
Okay.
So there was just one other thing.
That's what I
just wanted to talk about tonight, and that is we had proposed, or a position of a capital projects manager was proposed, and after some discussions with Facilities Director Alani, who's here tonight to answer any questions you might have about this, I would say that we are prepared to do this position or establish this position without affecting the operating budget. And what we foresee in the next year to 2 years is a heavier, more engaged period of time for larger capital projects, including the Lane School addition. We also have our communications plan or system that we're moving in the direction of implementing. And we need someone, as we have had in the past during a period of high activity in capital budgets and projects, we need a person to serve in a role of being manager of those major projects. In reality, state law actually requires the establishment of a owner's project manager for projects that are over $1.5 million. Those are building projects. So we will need a position like this in the Lane School project, and the present estimates that we're developing for the Lane School project would include funding for this position. And what we'd like to do is propose that we fund it 1/3 through the Lane School project, 1/3 through the communications project, and then the final third would be accomplished through savings that we can ensure in the energy budget in the facilities department. And this position would also replace and take on some of the tasks of the energy shared energy planner that we had had with the town of Arlington. Unfortunately, the person has left that position, and we haven't replaced that function yet in the organization. We have a variety of smaller projects too that would be underway, and we would envision this person who might be hired to this position helping with the overall management of our capital budget process and plans. So it doesn't have an effect as proposed on the overall guideline number, mm-hmm. but I just thought we would review this concept with you tonight, just so you understood what we'd like to do here.
I appreciate the creative thinking that went into that. It struck me when I first read about the proposal that it seemed like a good possibility to fund this as part of the project cost, but I'm concerned about some of the miscellaneous responsibilities you mentioned. I guess I'm concerned about adding to the headcount and our obligations for benefits and retirement benefits. And at some point when the capital demand subsides, whether we'll have ourselves another position.
Well, we did establish a position like this once before, and we made it clear to the person we hired.
I remember that.
It was a temporary position. That's right. The way we would, go with this position. If such that if there isn't enough activity in the capital budget, but we see a few building projects coming along here, and we have a sense that probably someone could be serving in this position, and we will need somebody right away when the Lane School project gets underway. We will need somebody probably if Davis School has something after Lane School, we'll probably need a person in this capacity for at least 3 years.
So just to Mike's point, so does a temporary position carry benefits, and does it carry long-term benefits?
Well, they would have benefits.
They have benefits while they're here.
Yes, exactly. Yes. And then the only way they would become long-term eligible is if they happen to have enough hours or years of service elsewhere, or eventually here, if that were the case.
Right.
We can share it.
You
can share it with wherever they go afterwards, yes. Or share it with whether we've been.
Okay. Now, this is separate from the position that would be called clerk of the works, right? Do they still have that position on a project?
Well, in...
Yes, the...
That's it.
Yes.
Under the project, so a bigger construction project, you would have both.
But for a smaller one, like the Lane School, the same person can do both.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When we did the high school we had a separate clerk of the works from the capital projects manager. In fact, actually, at those times, this wasn't a requirement of the law. We were sort of ahead of the curve in a sense by creating a position like that to really manage the capital project for the town.
Any other thoughts or questions about that prospect?
I just agree with Mike. I think it was good to have such creative thinking about how to deal with it.
Well, the position was critical to the last round of projects, and as we anticipate another round of projects, both we're legally obligated for some of them, and it just makes sense to have the expertise available to us for some of the other projects, even if the law cuts off at a dollar amount and some of those projects don't trigger the position. So we could return back to the rest of the budget if people have comments or questions on any of the other departments. We made it through some of the list last time.
I promise you this half or whatever it is of the budget will go considerably faster.
You got to talk fast?
Well, not only will I talk fast, but we left off with the code department as the beginning place on page 58, but I didn't personally have any questions about that department or about voc ed is not our concern technically. But when we got to facilities on page 68, there's a line item that's called roof maintenance, and just to be clear, my memory is that we decided that was a recurring item and that we were going to have it part of the facilities budget going forward and not as a capital project. And that we'll be seeing that regularly and probably increasing due to inflation, but at least that's where it came from. Sorry, I just have to look at each page. Public Works, page 75, under refuse. I'm confused about the paper and other recyclables that may have value on the open market, although right now they're rather minimal, if not non-existent. Is the offset of that money go directly to the refuse company, or do we see it as an offset in here?
It would seem as an offset in the bill that we pay.
Oh, so it's buried in the bill. Okay.
Yeah. Although right now,
it's pretty much zero.
Yes.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
That bad? Huh?
Yes.
But still better than sending it to be weighed and burned.
Yes.
We're not paying or being paid.
Right.
So when it was happening, it was offset.
We're not paying as much.
I will just remind the selectmen that in the proposed budget here on paper, this is indicating that the budget would go up about $50,000, slightly under that. However, that's really a placeholder because we do not have firm estimates yet from the suppliers. We're working on trying to get that. We offset this increase in the refuse budget with a decrease in the energy budget in the Public Works Department.
Along with using the rebuild.
Right.
So still in Public Works, but jumping to page 84. Electricity is there under energy, and I thought we had combined all electricity into...
The Public Works is the only department that was not combined with the utility department for utilities.
And there was a reason for that?
Because the Public Works is not building, it's roads, and it's also water and sewer, which is paid for the water and sewer rate. So the purpose behind combining it was all building utilities.
Okay. And some of that electricity is to drive the pumps that drive
the electricity.
Yeah, okay.
Is,
yep.
And the street lights.
And street lights. Okay. I told you this would be faster. Yeah, come on. Fingers are cold. Still stuck in Public Works, but nothing to ask about. Board of Health. Page 104.
Excuse me?
Board of Health, page 104.
They are independent.
They're independent. I guess I just draw to everybody's attention, they were in talking to the Finance Committee that they had lost a grant for mosquito control, if I recall correctly. What?
Tick control.
Tick control, I'm sorry, yes. And they were looking for more money to cover that.
What did that do? Was that the, like, the tick survey when people would collect their ticks and send them in?
Yes.
Yeah. It was the testing.
I thought that was a temporary thing anyway.
It was.
I mean,
They're looking for additional money in the professional services now. It's up $1,000, it's $1,000 for one particular project and $1,500 for another.
Was one of them to repeat the tick survey access? It basically gave Bedford residents access to UMass Analytical Services.
Right, without looking at Apple.
Having mailed a tick to UMass, they do, in fact, I do.
Do you have to put extra postage?
No, but you have to be very careful with the way you send a tick in the mail.
Something the director believes in and she made a case for, I believe that was $1,500 and $2,000 for another project. Details of which escaped me at the moment.
Right, I can tell you right now, I mean.
They were $3,500 over plus $800 negative, merit drove them $800 negative.
$1,000 was to add a partnership with the URI for the tick bite prevention and education services. And $1,500 was to add a community education program for suicide prevention and, what's it called, opioid?
Opioid.
And then they had a slight difference in salaries due to the fact that the guideline's 2.5% and the merit is more than age of 3.3.
But the tick program was for, was?
Is for tick bite prevention and education services.
With URI or UMass?
URI is probably an acronym for something and I just don't remember.
University of Rhode Island.
University of Rhode Island.
Sent the tests too, I think.
But the original was at UMass. It's interesting that it would shift from one.
This is different.
Maybe all the ticks moved into Rhode Island.
Mark wants to make sure he mailed it to the right spot.
Oh, no, I got an answer, believe me. And I have to say, it was reassuring. You send it off, they send it back, they send you emails, and then fortunately.
This could help us get a quorum, so.
Certainly more than the.
All right.
Moving onward, hazardous waste, 107. Just one of the goals, the goal on the far lower left is a very old goal that goes back to 2014. Maybe somebody needs to reread what they hand in. I just note that.
That goal has been met.
Because that's already been done. Bedford Local Transit, 111. Under Personnel Services, I know that it just seems like a big jump from the actual.
Page 113, Bill?
Page 111.
113, if you want to look at 113.
Yeah.
It gives you the summary.
I know, but it doesn't tell me why.
Well, 2% is the COLA, so that would be on the BLT Operating Coordinator. She is given a 2% increase based on the salary bylaw, and then the $4,100 was due to the transit service pilot book. It was a little shy of 4,100, it was like 4,088. So the 104,000 that you set aside for the transit program,
yeah.
4,080 went to personnel service, and the difference of 100,716 went to the consultant, contracted transit services on page 112. So if you look on 112, on the contracted transit services, you'll see an amount there for 100,716. And then if you look in the personnel, you'll see two amounts there, which total 1,848.34 and 2,229.38. The total of all that equals the $104,000 contingency request for the transit services.
You're looking at a different page 112 than I am.
Yeah. Did you have...
I don't see the...
Did you switch books? Switch, we got a new one tonight.
Got a new set?
No, I didn't look at the, I'm looking at the one that got handed out.
I don't think anything changed.
There was a new set in our package.
So on page 112, there's a line that says salaries.
Yep.
There's a line that says purchase of service.
Nope.
He's looking at the old.
Nope.
It's old, yep.
There was a new set in our package.
I didn't want to go through page by page after I'd gone through this one to look at that one.
It's missing.
Well, there you go.
If you look at that page, it's different, Mike.
Okay.
If you look at it, it has the services, yes.
Peace.
That was certainly explaining the reason for it.
There's also a...
I do have limited time in spite of the fact that it doesn't look like it. Council on Aging, page 117 in my old version.
The only thing that changed from the new and the old version, though, was the finance department. We added the $35,000 in there.
And the BLT.
Yeah.
Other than that, nothing else changed.
That's fine. Why is there such a significant increase in budgets for the last 2 years when the actuals for the previous two fiscal years is considerably low?
Because we have vacancies in the Council on Aging. That's the director. So that would call to the reasons as to why the budget actual is so less.
Okay. We're getting there, guys. We're almost there. Youth and Family Services, 121. Tell me a little bit about veterans' benefits.
Well, we level funded it in part because last year we spent $114,000 and it's budgeted at $170,000. The reason why we're not decreasing it is because presently there's a new apartment project being built over there at the VA, which we expect will have an impact on increasing veterans' benefits for the town. We don't really...
This is because of the housing project that's going in there?
Yes.
Okay.
We're keeping it at 170 because of that.
Yeah. Okey doke. Sorry, my fingers aren't operating fast. I think we're almost there. I think I see one more. Then we'll declare victory. Two more. Ambulance Enterprise Fund, 137. The holiday salaries jumped up significantly from even looking at budgets, let alone against actuals.
Sure.
This is because of new hires?
Yes. The holiday salary is obviously based on the hiring in that department. Everybody was hired last year in the paramedic as a student, step one. Now these paramedics are going to step two and step three, which will increase the holiday budget. Also, if you look at the salary line, those increase too.
Yep. And I think they have one last one. Also in the ambulance enterprise, next page, 138. Talk to me a little bit about quality assurance and medical control.
That is all related to the paramedic service. Is what required to operate your paramedic service. I'm not completely bad, but quality assurance is, are we operating correctly? If someone comes in, we use the paramedic services and make sure that we're following all the rules and regulations and the policies so that we're operating a good service. I don't know what else. So.
Thank you
this
for...
This is part of the whole paramedic presentation.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you. I think we've looked at every page that I had problems with. I don't know if anybody else had any other concerns.
Questions or comments about the budget? All right. So we have...
Next week is...
So we have one more meeting before...
Unless you want to vote to recommend it tonight, it's up to you. fixed, yes.
I actually have a total.
Yeah, we they have it, too.
Yeah.
I think the total budget is... I mean, we don't have to do it tonight. We can do it next Monday night.
Why don't we do that?
Still an issue of the pilot.
Yes.
Yeah. We probably should give that some more thought. And we have until Monday to be able to go to finance. We're scheduled for a week from Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Good.
Yep.
All right. Okay, then. Thanks.
I'll even substitute the new one for the old one now.
Okay. Yeah. All right, we're on to review of draft warrants, and we got a new one on the table tonight, so...
But all my notes are in the old one.
That's the plan.
Well, Rick, maybe we could start by, can you tell us what's new between the one we had over the weekend and the one we got tonight? There are two more articles.
There's two additional articles. Instead of there being 29 articles, there are 31. Now, the two articles that were added were the article that's listed on the new version of the warrant as article... actually, it's a general bylaw amendment for wetlands protection, mm-hmm. So it's Article 7. Actually, we just forgotten in the first version from the weekend to add that general bylaw proposal. The selectmen did hold a public hearing on the proposed wetlands protection bylaw amendment back on January 4th. So that would be added. And then the other one is Article number 15 on the new list, which is now Bedford Business Zoning Appropriation. This is the $120,000 request from the Planning Board to have a consultant come in and work on studying the business zones along the Great Road and eventually recommending changes to the zoning and zoning bylaws. Otherwise, the articles are the same. There were some articles that were missing text last Friday that we worked on today and drafted the text for the bylaws the articles. And those were really, let's see, Article 16, the easement acquisition. I will also say these are all not in final form. They're still in draft. The next one is the Mudgeway Street Acceptance. Also the contingent bond authorization for the Joe Blaine School addition. In the capital projects plan, we have all of the project titles listed in the capital article. That was different. I think that's basically it in terms of what changed since we saw on Friday.
I have a quick question, Rick, about Article 8 on the page place article. Is that not a petitioner's article?
Yes, it is.
It is.
So it doesn't say that anywhere. Uh-huh. The title doesn't issue, indicate that it's from a petitioner or the italicized comment. So one or the other. The one that is from the zoning board is noted as being from the zoning board in the title of the article. I don't know whether that... We're confused.
Yeah, that was just more or less for internal purposes to keep track. I don't know if that needs to stay in the title of the article. We can probably just handle that.
But in the italicized, it just seems in both of those, The italicized section should make it clear that the page place article is from petitioners.
Yeah.
That's six.
Is Article 6.
Page 32.
Page
32.
Okay.
So then the italicized section is way over on...
Yeah, usually what 37. Has been done with petitioner's articles is at the end of the article, the formal part of the article, there's an italicized things put in there, like right after.
It's there.
Oh, it's there, it just doesn't mention.
No, before that, it's, it, in tradition is to put the word submitted by petition.
Right.
Right after pass any vote, take any action relative to here too.
Okay.
I'll go back and look at what we've done in the past.
So going back to the beginning, although many of these are still in draft form, are there questions or comments about any of the articles that people saw in here?
I have a bunch of editorial things I'd like to suggest.
Can those be done, like, independently of this meeting, if they're just like commas and type?
Those things I'm happy to do. Let me just make sure, I'll be happy to do that if, I just.
I will also say that on the summary list that we passed out showing 31 articles tonight, you'll note that the hearing dates for all the zoning bylaw amendments are shown. So the hearings begin on February 2nd, continue on February 9th, and then the last couple will be on March 2nd.
And it's the planning board that holds the public hearing, no matter who the proponent is, including the ZBA proposed zoning change?
Yes.
ZBA doesn't hold hearings on zoning changes.
Correct.
I mean, they can have their own discussion about it, but it's still the planning board's responsibility to hold the hearing for all of the zoning articles, yeah? Okay.
Mike, keeping with your request, I'm happy to do that. I just have then, I think, two questions. One is, all these are in the part about capital, and there's no page numbers here, but 17-25, water and sewer.
Yeah, page 8 in this one.
Page 8.
In the new one.
In the new one. As I said, all my stuff is in the old one. It says, in the last line, it says, the cost of the contract will be recouped with revenue from the testing of the devices. That isn't testing, it's got to be something else.
No, that's correct. What happens is backflow devices have to be tested on a periodic basis, and so fees are charged for the testing of the devices on a regular basis that testing occurs.
Testing is buried in the water and sewer charges?
No, it's a cross-connect charge.
So this is strictly for industry?
Right, it's a cross-connect charge.
Yes.
Okay.
I think every year
right.
You have to have.
It's not in your water and sewer rate.
Okay, yep. The other is, thank you, Mr. Rosen, for creating all this capital expenditure over the next 5 years information. I assume you were the one who did it. The facilities department does not have any sub breakdown per se, and there's some fairly large dollar values there. Or am I misreading? The water, sewer, those are all DPW.
Facilities actually would be. I'm sorry. Never mind.
No, go ahead.
I'm wrong about that. Well, school buildings that facilities works on. And other schools are in the top part of the section.
Maybe you could break that out a little somehow, because there's just such a large, I mean, $2 million without any explanation is a little bit too much to just look at and say, yep. Again, what we're trying to do, just to remind everybody, is to educate the public so that when they come in a year from now, they won't say, gee, I didn't know that was coming, to the extent that we know something's coming. So that would be very helpful. Something. Just the big ones. And they certainly can be grouped as you have everywhere else. Thank you. Other things are editorial. I'll get that to you separately, Rick.
Okay.
Okay. Thoughts, comments, or concerns on the list so far, or the topics?
The length.
The length.
The what?
The length.
The length.
That's your zoning bylaw.
Yeah.
Actually, so, put together very organized.
One area where I know we can save space is that there are sections of the wetlands protection bylaw that are not changing, and it just says current text, and it goes down to the next section of current text.
Yeah.
If we take those out where there's no amendments, then you don't have a complete bylaw in front of you. We can go through here and eliminate those sections. We could also provide a copy at town meeting of the complete bylaw for those who want to see the whole bylaw. Certainly would save space in the warrant and reduce printing costs for the warrant if we want to approach it that way. This is the way that Conservation Commission
provided
together
it, right.
the bylaw.
And the other thing that is unfortunately somewhat confusing is that when they've renamed the sections, it's not obvious that that's what's happening.
No.
So the current text of 54.2 is jurisdiction, and then the proposed text of 54.2 is purpose. But what happened to jurisdiction? Well, jurisdiction went down to 54.3.
Right. What they need is
somehow.
Like a spreadsheet or a table like the charter.
I think that's what we thought about at the beginning.
I think we did suggest that. But
that's for town meeting. Yeah.
Proposed and.
Well, it should be for the warrant as well, I think. For simplicity of reading.
Yeah.
Just don't know, Rick, whether there's a way to make this look and feel more like the general bylaw changes that we've made in past town meetings. Mm-hmm. We'll have to look at this. But I do recognize you're right. This is what they gave us, and I was under the impression they were going to try to do something more, but that may not have happened.
The commission itself is not meeting to discuss what came out of that public hearing until the first week in February.
Okay.
Would
it be possible, rather than organizing it by section, just to put the current text and the proposed text and then just have the italic or a strike through or something to show that the section right. has changed, so that at very least in the warrant you can match up like with like?
Weren't they like next to each other on the page?
No, I don't think so. It was really hard to
do
a comparison. But and most of it is just what you'd call house.
Look at past warrants. All right. So there's more work on the wetland bylaw presentation.
Yep.
How this is going to get put out there.
Yeah, because that is a lot.
Does anybody else? There's a lot in there. But I agree with you. I don't think we need to. Town meeting doesn't have to see in front of it in the warrant the entire bylaw. We need to know what the changes are. And they're all in one article. So hopefully we don't have one person objecting to one change in one section, which would block the entire thing. So, right. Are there any other questions for now on the warrant as we're looking at it?
I assume we'll be looking at a few more times.
A couple more times.
3 weeks in a row.
Yeah.
Unless we finish sooner than that.
All right. Okay, so we can commit it to memory by our next meeting. All right. We are on to minutes. Executive session of January 4th.
I have just one minor thing. Where the motion is Mr.
Yes.
Moonen, a motion.
Right.
I think the word made would
made
be
a motion. Yeah, or moved.
Or moved.
Mr. Moonen
made
moved.
A motion or moved
yes.
to accept. One or the other. Other than that, I was happy.
Move Selectmen approve the executive session minutes of January 4, 2016.
Second.
Moved and seconded to accept the January 4th executive session minutes as amended. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, abstained, 500. Regular session minutes of January 19th.
Page 2. The paragraph that starts next, Mr. Hunt, the last sentence in that paragraph, says the overall debt services were $7.1 million, which is, which is 7.5% of the overall debt expenses. And the, skip a paragraph, the next one, Mr. Hunt informed the selectmen that there was a new requirement as of that statement. And then over on page four, under 16169, third line down, the sentence starts out, the initial report was that the budget would be approximately 30,000, it's not less, it would be more than the previous estimate. Have to delete all that next section.
No, no, it was less.
It was less, that was the initial.
Yeah, that was the initial.
Right?
It's correct as written, Bill.
It was only the contingencies that kicked it over.
Right.
That's right, we were under guideline.
Yeah, but not by $30,000.
Yes.
Yeah.
There were some initial submissions.
I'm looking at your own pieces of paper.
Well, you're not keeping up with what has transpired over time. There was originally,
This is the one you handed me last week. Is $30,000 suddenly appeared out somewhere?
If you look at the,
Bottom line.
If you look at the column that says personnel ser, it's about midway through here, estimated.
Yeah.
1% increase total, yeah. Down at the bottom, see the figure 30,405?
It says below.
Yeah.
And above. Okay, I misread it.
Because it didn't have the brackets, right?
No. Yeah. Right.
That's okay. What threw you off.
My apologies.
Right. Usually bracket.
But, right, the brackets then, means we were out of line, as a put.
I apologize.
We've been through this several times, I think, trying
too
to.
Too many numbers lately. But in that same paragraph, then, and see, I'll probably be wrong again. The addition of these items would make the budget 1244 less than the Finance Committee's guidelines. And if you add in the three contingencies items, it'll actually make it $227,550 more than the Finance Committee's guideline.
Yeah, so upon further review.
There were some other additions that add before that.
Take away the number three contingency items and just say add certain contingency items. And then it's correct.
But the number is 227,550 more.
No, the budget after adding certain contingency items was still 1,244 less than the
contingency items are $104,000?
It has to be.
There were other contingencies.
It has to be separated. Right. There has to be another sentence here.
There's something missing then.
Then instead of Mr. Reed stated that the additional contingency items were, it should say that.
Further contingency items.
Now, or you can take out the word.
You're right, Rick. There were minor budget changes that you were suggesting inside the budget that was already below guideline.
Yes.
That brought us to just about to guideline.
Yes.
But now the big three.
Yes.
Were even on top of those.
Yes.
That's where the separation.
Okay.
I noticed that.
I'm obviously half a stroke behind.
No, it was wrong.
Apologies.
No,
end of comment.
No, you're right. It was not tracking.
Didn't make
sense. Wasn't clear.
The numbers were in fact correct, but the language didn't support them.
Thank you.
Y'all set for. Anybody else have comments on? Yes.
Page 10. Oh. Go ahead.
I just have a brief one under 16168 Fond Lake presentation on page 4. Where it has the bulleted criteria that the committee used to evaluate the options, we're actually missing half of them, one half, but not the other. So we need to add effectiveness of removing, reducing unwanted vegetation, overall project costs, neighborhood impacts, and time to permit. And those were all on the slide that Bill Simons presented.
Anything else?
That's it.
Page 2, the second paragraph that starts with next Mr. Hunt, which is a short paragraph, and it refers to a manager's letter. It's actually the management letter, and I think it's important to change that so people don't think it was written by the town man.
Right.
And then on six regarding the General Electric facilities at Hanscom. Fourth paragraph under 174, there's reference to the helicopter at Hanscom. The helicopter isn't going to be stationary, it's just going to land and take off there, so I think you can drop those words and a helicopter. And then further down, it says, Mr. Rosenberg stated that Massport anticipated that having hangar space available would cut down on the air traffic noise. And change anticipated to contends, present tense, because this is a point they make now, even without GE. Mm-hmm. That's it.
I apologize, but I found another one.
Mm-hmm. Too late.
I lost my turn. On page six, also an open discussion, the second paragraph where I was talking about the Energy Task Force. The second to the last sentence that begins, the Energy Task Force would like to see, and what they would like to see is Good Energy's response to the MAPC RFP. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now I'm done.
Okay. Any other corrections? A motion to approve as amended.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve as amended the January 19th minutes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstained. 5-0-0. We are on to town manager's report.
I'm all set for tonight.
Okay. Open discussion. Bill?
I don't know. Did anybody else besides myself go to see Ms. Poundstone afterwards? She made a very interesting comment. She was interviewing people from the audience.
That's how she...
Getting them to contribute. And one of the things she asked the guy, said, what program did you go to this afternoon? He said, I went to Incomplete Streets. She said, what? I mean, I went to Complete Streets.
No, I thought that was the joke.
Streets. She said, so does that mean you have partial streets in your town?
Well, yes.
And she went on from
She's
there.
Funny.
The other thing was, one of the things that got handed to us at the... Maybe somebody here knows, it's just my own curiosity. At the bottom of the notice from Bill Ricca about the the work that's going on there, it says America's Yankee Doodle Town. What does that mean?
Bill Ricca is branding itself as the Yankee Doodle Town.
It has been for years.
Is that because the guy who wrote it was from there or something?
Yeah, I believe so.
Is that
some history of some sort?
That's their
George M. Cohen.
Out of this whole notice, that's what you do.
The Yankee Doodle Day or something.
Yeah.
And I've already talked to you about what went on FinCom, so
that's
the end of my report.
One of the things that was pointed out this year at the annual open meeting log session at the MMA annual meeting was that periodically it would be helpful to release executive session minutes that no longer, you know, they can stay. They're confidential until the purpose for the executive session is has been resolved, and sometimes it never is. But apparently there was a town where somebody came in and demanded every executive session minutes for the past 200 years, and it created quite a lot of pressure on people. So it doesn't have to be done as a board. I would volunteer to review the ones for the years since I've been here and then propose their release as one motion if you wish, if that would be helpful. I mean, it doesn't have to be me, it could be anybody, but it doesn't have to be a board process, apparently, to do the review.
To do the review to determine whether or not whether or not the topic is closed?
Yeah. And then you take the, and then you can move the ones that, where it's obvious they have been and just release.
Do we not release executive session minutes? In any organized way that we know of?
No process of doing that, no.
Okay. That's interesting because you went to the open meeting law update and I went to the public records law update, which actually I should have mentioned while we were talking about the budget. Not because I think that there will definitely be an implication for the budget, but they did raise the prospect that the current schedule which may or may not hold as this thing continues to move through the legislature, but a version of public records law has passed the House, is headed into the Senate as they start up their new session, currently has an effective date of July 1 for the designation of an information officer in all communities. That person having the ability then to designate additional information officers, and a compliance date, I'm pretty sure they said September 1st or October 1st. So very shortly after you have this person in place, then they're about 3 months to get geared up to be able to comply with all of the requirements that are in the new statute. The budget implication is just simply in time, and it may in fact take a designated person. It may be there are personnel in communities that can already serve this function, are serving it now, and then get this official title. There's a part of the law that, as currently written, requires the provision of 2 hours of free services in pursuit of providing the information before you calculate then the time necessary to continue to comply with the services, with the request for information. It was a very animated conversation, I'd say. There are a lot of communities apparently that have requests that feel very unreasonable to them from the public around public information. A lot of them acknowledging that there are very straightforward requests for minutes and documents that are very accessible. Communities can do that relatively easily, but apparently there are individuals who ask for 200 years worth of records. So there may be a cost implication coming down the pike. It may not start on July 1. It may not be something that we have to worry about necessarily right away, but there may be some costs. And I know that there's been a lot of debate about the extent of the proposed statute, but the speakers were anticipating something will happen, and there will be changes in the way the public can ask for and receive public information, public records. So,
is the MMA still opposing the legislation?
They are. I think what they said basically was that they are a lot more comfortable with the version that the House has put out. It's not perfect, but they can live with it. The speakers basically indicated that if the Senate tries to add additional requirements at the local level, then the MMA is likely to object and say, you know, we were okay with the version that was sent to you. They're feeling like it's at the edge of what is reasonable and doable at the local level. But I think the answer is they really would, if something has to happen, the House version is the end of the line as far as the advocacy organizations are concerned. Now, you know, there are a lot of advocacy organizations on the other side. So
yeah,
it's anybody's guess so far as to what the Senate will do. They did describe a very constrained process that's been indicated on the Senate side. They will literally put out a copy of the bill and take it to the Senate the next day. So they're going to try not to have the whole world attempt to amend the Senate version, but no one will really know exactly what it looks like until very short notice. And they anticipate it's going to happen soon. So
yeah.
Anyway, between.
Yeah, there was some overlap on those two. Yeah.
That's anyway, sorry, did you have anything else?
No.
Okay. Well, I didn't either, so.
I've got a couple things to report out of the MMA. I attended a workshop on building age-friendly communities, and I forwarded to everybody the profile from the Massachusetts Healthy Aging Collaborative that gives you some statistics on our town. But it was an interesting presentation because it both was sort of a moment of recognition of how large the scale of this issue is in terms of the rate at which our population is aging. And if you look at our profile, as of the 2010 census, we had 23% of our population was 60 years or older. And so you're looking at a trajectory for a lot of communities like ours where that's going to become a substantial portion of our population, or an even more substantial part of our population.
So we were both there, but there was that statistic that said that at the end of the calendar year 2016, the population over 65 will be greater than the population under 20 for the first time in history.
In the state?
In the state.
In the state.
In the state, anyway.
I think it was, the numbers that were somewhere for the state.
Yeah, for the state.
Yeah.
Wow.
So it was interesting to note that in their presentation, the panelists touched on a lot of the things that Medford is involved with, including the complete streets issue as an issue regarding like universal design and accessibility for people of all ages. What they say is if you're in a wheelchair, you need the same accommodation as someone who's pushing a stroller. So it was interesting to see the extent to which they were talking about built environment issues in addition to other issues having to do with social support and services and councils on aging and other things. But they did specifically mention the complete streets and also Vision Zero, which if you're not familiar with is an initiative to bring to zero the number of traffic fatalities, essentially people being killed by pedestrians and cyclists being killed by vehicles. And Boston is engaged in this. Obviously, it's aspirational. It's not going to happen. We're, you know, lucky that we don't have a lot of traffic injuries, but nonetheless, as you get aging populations who need more time to cross streets, and you need streets that are built with short enough crosswalks so that people can get out there and be active, these were all things that they were putting in the context of aging populations. I know that we talk about complete streets having to do with maybe younger or more the commuters or the cyclists, but it was really, really interesting to hear the perspective from Mass Mobility and from the AARP and have them all be advocating for us on the municipal level to be working hard to implement complete streets and universal design in our built environment. So that was number one. I also attended a workshop in issues in municipal policing, and it was a great panel. Commissioner Evans from Boston was there. Two other police chiefs from their major cities group were there. And they talked a lot about fair and impartial policing and a lot of the issues that are in the news and the questions regarding the use of force and how police departments draft their policies, review their policies. And I just wanted to call out Bedford for our being progressive on this issue. I know Caroline and I and Bill all attended the fair and impartial policing training that the Bedford Police and actually the Arlington Police did together. And members of the community were invited in to help break down those barriers. And I was just impressed by the presentation at the MMA about how well we're doing relative to our counterparts and how well Massachusetts is doing relative to other states on this issue. And I think that's it.
Okay. You had more, right?
One more thing. I wanted just to follow up. The next ZBA meeting is the 4th of February, which is also the night that the Selectman's budget is going to the FinCom. So I'm not going to be able to go, but I promise you an update about what's going on with our teardown issues at the ZBA. Okay, now I'm done.
Okay. One small fact from Youth and Family Service and BCP, both meetings, just an update on the Bedford Plaza. There's 14 families that remain at the Bedford Plaza. Many have moved out, and they are moving out using housing vouchers to go into permanent apartments, and that number is expected to steadily decline. So we haven't talked about that in some time. I thought you'd like to hear an update. An update from Recreation Commission regarding Springsbrook Park. It's not a total update, but I'll give you what I have. So we had talked briefly last meeting about the long-term plans, that they had done a survey and that there's a lot of interest from town residents for a facility with pools. They had gone into a feasibility study at some point through using revolver money, and the end result came back with numbers between $11 and $16 million for a complex. Bottom line is it can happen there. It just has a big price tag and years out. So they're moving forward into next steps of, you know, kind of breaking that down and seeing.
Is that a year-round facility or a seasonal facility?
No, I'm sorry, just a swimming facility. Did I say year-round?
No, I'm asking the question whether 11 to 16 means a building. Or open-air pools.
Open-air pools. Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, three of them for various populations and purposes. along with a lot of other amenities and changes to the park, but obviously that's the biggest cost structure. So in the meantime of continuing to pursue that for a longer-term plan and coming in front of the selectmen and other boards for, with more details, the short-term plan was to look at last summer and figure out what to do with this summer, and any summer between now and when the pools become, you know, a little deeper in conversation. So they went through some numbers, and I'll rattle them off to you so you get a sense of it. So we operated last summer, to remind everybody, we were not open on the weekends. It was just a weekday. The general purpose, the main purpose for that was for safety reasons. On the weekends, the water seems to get stirred around a lot more, and it was causing more of a clarity issue. So they closed it down and only opened on the weekdays. That operated at a loss of $35,000 for the summer, probably the smallest loss in, you know, 10 years since I've been following Strings River Park and the money. So that's kind of right on par for what they've had. But just to put that in perspective, so the revenue was about $200,000, and this is leading to what they're deciding, the commission is deciding to do with this upcoming summer. Out of the $200,000, about $85,000 of it came from lessons, membership, and concessions. $115,000 came from walk-ins. So let me say that again. So the memberships were $39,000. So those are mostly Bedford people, Bedford residents. $115,000 were from people who did not have a membership and walked in. Of that $114,000, roughly $14,000 of them were from Bedford. So there's about $100,000 in of $200,000 in revenue that are from out-of-town walk-ins visits. So just to kind of put that. And then another fact that was surprising to me, 3% of the, only less than 3% of Bedford residents are members at Strings River Park. So there's a really small, you know, kind of response to Strings River Park currently, today. And then, you know, where it kind of leads to, so they had some choices. You know, do they run it just like they did last year? And they operate and, you know, kind of expect to get in the same revenue, expect to get the same clientele, and expect to run at the same loss of, you know, minus 35,000. Or try to serve Bedford residents. You know, the feedback that they get is, the commission gets a lot, is the weekends, people miss the weekends being open, and it would be nice if it was a Bedford residents-only place. Obviously, the money's coming from elsewhere, and so they could say, well, it's a Bedford residence facility only, and we're potentially at a loss of $100,000 this coming summer. We could run it just the way that it was, or we could come up with something in between. And so what they did was they came up with something in between. And keep in mind that the idea is to come up with a short-term plan to get us, get the commission to figuring out what the longer-term plan is. So the short-term current plan that was voted on Friday night is to change the membership to be Bedford residents and limited members only. So you can't just walk in. You have to commit to a membership. You have to be invested in it. So if you live out of town, you have to be a member, and you can't just walk in. So that's a big change. It's taking a big risk financially, because much of the money is coming in from that, but their hope. And they're also adding four or five amenities. There's a gearing much more towards a younger population, because that's kind of where the facility is right now. They're adding a playground, a Gaga pit, which I've never done, but I guess that's really popular now. Some spray functions in the shallow part of the pond for toddlers, and some canopies, four or five canopies for shade. So they're adding amenities, hoping for, because it's going to be only Bedford residents can walk in, they're hoping to kind of attract more Bedford residents without losing too much, taking too much of a financial risk. So that was what they voted on. And I'm open to questions on that.
Can I ask a question?
Sure, I can see if I can answer it, but there's okay. A lot to it.
I guess what I'm understanding from their actions is that the thought process they have is that the presence of non-residents is somehow depressing the population of residents that are attending, and that by eliminating non-residents, you're somehow going to get more residents there. Because it seems like what they've just done is taken $100,000 out of their budget, right? Mm-hmm. The non-residents.
Did they consider the possibility of opening it on weekends for Bedford residents only, or doing something sort of like a time when it was residents only to test that hypothesis that the reason that Bedford people weren't coming was because of the presence of non-residents? Because it seems to me this is very risky in terms of the financial model for the
sure,
the pond.
Sure.
And although I know it's intended to be make it more welcoming for Bedford residents, as a user of the pond, other than when it's extremely crowded, I'm not quite sure what the presence of non-residents is doing to the overall scene of the place,
mm-hmm.
except making it seem
more crowded.
Lively, you know, that there's people there, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, so I guess I wondered if you could explain their thinking on this.
Well, and let me just clarify. So non-residents are welcome to come in.
Right, but
with a membership.
The walk-in, but you broke down the numbers and that there was a number that you assigned to the
$100,000.
$100,000.
Half of the revenue.
To the walk-ins.
Absolutely.
So they're saying no to that $100,000.
Yes, they are.
That's an interesting thought.
Yep. Yeah, there's a lot that goes deeper, and it was a torn vote, and I think the conversations are still happening. But I think in the bottom line, the majority of the feedback that the Rec Commission gets from many different directions is that they, for the taxpayers' dollars to pay for the park, they would like it to be more of a park that is available to Bedford residents, that Bedford residents have given the feedback that they would like it to be Bedford residents only. And that's what the commission is hearing. You're looking out there if there's any other feedback. So just reporting, I'm the liaison.
No,
this is the
Rec
Commission. This is the vote.
And are there capacity issues?
There's a lot of issues that come up with overcrowding on the weekends,
and
but overcrowding
on the really hot days. Yeah.
On the really hot days for the walk-ins.
Yeah.
And you come in and there's limitations on the number of people in families that can come in, and there's kind of a cap to the dollar amount. But what you get is somebody coming in at the front of the line and saying that, you know, these 12 people are part of my family, and they're coming in on one family walk-in dollar amount.
Mm-hmm.
So there was lots of conversations about how to stop that and control that and charge different things and charge too much for this and have it be free for Bedford. And there was the conversation went every mm-hmm. different direction for months, mm-hmm. honestly.
Mm-hmm.
But this is this is what the commission has decided is the best short term. And as Springsville Park for the past 5 years has done, we'll reassess after another mm-hmm. season.
So
they are revisiting the weekend. They're revisiting the weekends.
They'll be remaining closed for the weekends.
They're remaining closed for the weekends, but they are revisiting that one point. Mm-hmm. I think there's on the next meeting they'll talk about mm-hmm. opening up on select weekends for maybe Bedford residents, I think was the direction it was going.
So I guess I just have a procedural question, which is having the Rec Commission having taken this particular position relative to the usage of Springsbrook Park, is that the ultimate decision? And do the selectmen have any role in modifying that in any way, or is that essentially what
goes? I don't know if you're asking me that.
I don't know, because of the practice, I think, of the selectmen has generally been to defer to the Rec Commission in terms of the running, the day-to-day running. This is a big departure from how we've run that facility, and I'm just wondering if the rest of the selectmen mm-hmm. have an opinion on whether or not that's something that we are content with and will continue to adhere to practice of the past of just essentially saying whatever the Rec Commission decides is fine, or is this something that we'd like to hear more about before that is made final?
Other than historically, Rick, do we know the answer to who ultimately has the authority?
I think there...
Not for the commission. Just wanted to stand.
There is an enabling statute that was passed many years ago to establish the Rec Revolving Fund and the Rec Commission, and it may, my recollection is that it outlines what the authority of the Recreation Commission is in that statute.
And beyond investigating that, I would certainly be welcome to provide feedback back to the Rec Commission, you know, because the liaison reports both ways. So I'm happy to bring back any feedback or questions that we don't have answers to.
A question to take back is, so if you're going to cut down on the income side, are you going to not hire as many people as
Yes.
And you're going to...
The idea is to try to market it differently with new amenities and with kind of a new tagline that is, you know, mostly Bedford residents. They'll figure out the marketing piece of it and decrease the 100,000 as much as possible. I mean, that's what it was last year. So, you know, the idea is to try to have it be, you know, it was a $35,000 loss this year. So let's hope it's not a whole 100,000 with the new amenities and change of the marketing. And let's hope it's somewhere in between. I think that was the rationale was, you know, try to market it differently and try a different approach this year.
What was the percentage of Bedford people that came in, again, 3%?
That was the percentage of the
membership.
Residents.
Membership.
Who buy an annual membership.
Yep.
Yeah.
It was 3% of the...
Less than 2.8% of the Bedford residents of all of Bedford were members
right, of all ages.
Of all ages.
Yeah.
And 10% of that 2.8% were free memberships, given under scholarships. Or what the word is for that.
It's an uncomfortable conversation because it's inconsistent with other public recreational facilities. When
yep.
the people are, you know, the Minuteman bike trail is one of the most popular, probably the most popular bike trail in Eastern Mass, and you don't have to prove residency to use
and
it.
And we don't have any revenue from it either.
And we don't have, you know, the expenses are minimal.
Right.
You know, trail's the same thing. And
well, we expend monies to repave it. And
yeah, I think that, I think the expenditure is a big part of that psychology. And I mean, like the school committee has always rejected the concept of school choice, but has never been looked at as xenophobic for that reason.
I think the Rec Commission had a lot of conversations about having it be less crowded would be okay, that there's a happy medium to providing an amenity to Bedford residents that is inviting and welcoming and not overcrowded. Oh. And you know, it would be nice if it wasn't at a financial loss, but something in between is what they're going for. And the most of the feedback that they've received through Springsbrook Park and staff, through recreation staff, and through residents in the survey that they did, was the town would like a residence, not residence only, but you know, some place that they can go and it's not overcrowded, because Bedford is paying for it with their taxpayers.
Can you remind us when they did that survey? Was it before they were closed on the weekends?
Yeah.
Was it more than a year ago?
No.
Was it during this past
year? I think it was this past, okay. During this
because
past year.
Because
I'll find that
from,
out, though. I forget.
From the perspective of having been there for many years, the weekends were very, very crowded, and crowded with a lot of outsiders who were paying the gate mm-hmm. fee and, you know, spending the day and recreating with their families. And I think that the elimination of the weekends served to mitigate that in a certain sense, that you didn't have those very crowded days. There, and on the very hot days, they did limit it to members only, but and like 4th of July, it was members and Bedford residents only. So maybe they already have a certain practice of limiting the crowding on a, you know, when it's going to be 99 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
They'll, from the beginning of the day, that they'll put out the sign that says members only. So I feel as though the perception may be that it may have, it's possible, and if you can check on it to find out when those questions were asked,
mm-hmm.
that certainly in years past, the weekends were crowded with a lot of out-of-towners, absolutely, without a doubt. This past year, when it was only open during the week, I would wonder if the perception of that did not actually match the reality.
It is a reality. I don't have the numbers here, but I had asked that question as well, because I would assume that most
in terms of the crowding, there were
crowded,
the crowding.
Yes, yes.
So they have statistics on the crowd, yeah. How many days they were crowded?
They do.
Okay,
yep.
Great.
And I can get that too. And also, the there was some conversations about the sign going up to say residents only and not having that be proactively marketed that way, because there was a lot of disappointed people uh-huh. who came from afar, who didn't go to our website or didn't see that it was a members
right.
only day, and brought their family for a family day, and then were told at the gate.
Right.
So the idea, the conversation came up to make sure that we were being fair to people, you know, that
right.
are coming for the day.
I remember a conversation years ago that said that since a federal agency was involved in the original land acquisition for that facility, we couldn't limit it. Did anybody ever heard that before?
So Rick, you want to talk about the... reference back to town council?
Well, we have asked town council about whether or not we can restrict it, and the answer, I think, was generally been yes, but it's not been, that part of the picture has not been brought up, Mike, about it being purchased by the federal government and what, or from the federal government, and what that might mean in this situation. That's not been part of some of the recent opinions that have been generated on this.
So is the proposed plan consistent with town council's view of our authority to limit or not?
Yeah, town council said that there can be some restrictions on out-of-town people.
I'm not sure what that means, though. I mean, what restrictions?
I don't have it at the top of my head.
Yeah, okay. Well, it seems to me what would be helpful, at least from my vantage point, would be if Rec could come in and explain to us what it, basically give us a little presentation of what you just said. If we had in hand whatever it is town council can tell us about the town's ability to provide a facility for ourselves and others, and under what conditions we can say, yeah, but this is for us and this is for you, and you know, there are different times and days and conditions under which we can do that. And Rick, the question of, ultimately it's a town facility. It just seems a little odd that somehow the selectmen have no say over whether the Rec Commission, frustrated by being on the front line of all of this, can simply decide one way or the other how the place will operate under all conditions. I mean, yes, historically, that's part of why they're there serving all of us, but I find it hard to believe that it's
Since I've been involved, that's how it's run. By year to year, the decision for how the park would operate was decided at the Rec Commission.
Which I have no doubt that is the way it's been operating. I just would like, as Margaret says, I mean, when you start to get to some dramatic changes that may, in fact, simply keep people from coming to town, coming to the facility,
mm-hmm.
that perhaps we do have the authority. But I guess I would like to have understanding of all of this in front of us so that everybody so can make sure that everyone's comfortable with the way we are trying to approach the short-term mm-hmm. use of that.
Sure. Property. So on that note, I'm sure that they would be more than willing to come in and talk about it for two more months here, too. on that note, there's a timing issue because the Rec Commission has to get the brochure out and hire staff. So this we met on a Friday night because of the timing deadlines to make these decisions, and they had gone around for months. So I know our agendas are packed. If they can get next week, maybe Amy can hold off. You can talk to see if we have the time for the brochure and marketing the park. I know that there's a deadline coming, mm-hmm. short term.
Yeah, I think we faced this other last year or the year before, too. They were here sort of the night before they needed to go to press.
Sure.
Right.
So that my only thought is, in coming in, is if we could do it in the shortest order as possible. Mm-hmm. And then lastly, if you can believe that's not my last item, hopefully Rick can jump into this as well, but I know that there is a line item going in front of CPC tomorrow night regarding the design of Wilson Field, B Field, the soccer field here, to be developed into turf. And that was something that came out of Fields Partnership, which I'm a liaison to, and it's the department heads, DPW, Town Manager Reed, school committee,
recreation.
And so if you want to jump in a little bit from the Fields Partnership perspective, from the staff level, as to why it went that direction, but the Fields Partnership supported the direction for the next field to be developed was to be Wilson Field, B Field, and that it made the most sense to do that development as turf. And so there was a line item in the CPC.
By which you mean artificial?
Artificial turf, I'm sorry, yep. For $100,000 for the design of that, and add in anything that I'm missing. I think they're just looking, I think CPC might be looking for just the selectmen's support or input on that.
So this has been mentioned before to the selectmen, and most particularly, I think, at the time when the plans were going ahead for the Liljegren Way, Mudgeway Field Complex. And at the time, there was discussion late, I think, to the selectmen that there was a debate about natural turf at that location versus whether or not synthetic turf should be considered over there. And the choice was, in the end, natural turf. The Fields Partnership agreed. And again, Fields Partnership is not a committee. It's just staff representatives, so they don't have authority. They don't set policy. But, you know, they do discuss these things across departments. And so, in general, consensus of the Fields Partnership was that natural turf would make sense at the Liljegren Way, Mudgeway Field if we were to proceed with another turf field elsewhere. And the next field that is up for redevelopment is B Field or Wilson Field. And the other aspect of this is that any area that would potentially be turfed would also be lit. And so it made more sense to light a large field on the other side of the high school than it would be to consider doing this over at the Liljegren Way, Mudgeway Field Complex. So next year, in FY18, the Wilson Field was scheduled to be totally rehabbed, and I don't remember the specific dollar amount, but I know it's well over $200,000, mm-hmm. maybe around $250,000.
Yeah.
And the cost of that, of course, wouldn't be invested if we were going to proceed with consideration of a synthetic turf field in that location, and instead spend $100,000 for the design this year, and then eventually development of another turf field at that location. So this is the first step that is going ahead now. The Public Works Department had submitted a design request for the turf to the Community Preservation Committee for consideration of funding the early stages of planning and development of a turf field there. And presumably a year from now, there would be a follow-on request for a complete construction project. Of course, we know that the carpet for a turf field can't be funded with CPA funding, but other aspects of field redevelopment can be funded from community preservation.
And what's the current status on Liljegren Way?
It's under design now.
Yeah, do we know how much longer we're under design?
I don't have that tonight.
Isn't it coming up with CPC in this in
it's
package?
Be in the budget for the second half of the appropriation
true.
From CP funds. We didn't have enough last year to fund it in
yes,
full.
Yes, $600,000 was appropriated last year, right. And an additional $1 million is on the
600 last year.
Is proposed this year for Liljegren Way. So that has to pass in order for it to be constructed.
Right. No, I was just trying to get a sense of timing of
I think from what I heard from Fields Partnership, the idea is to have it be the next one after. I mean, if Liljegren takes longer than expected, then that could throw the timing, but the idea was to have it be the next one after that. So I if there's any questions, I'm not sure that I have the answers to them, but if it was any strong objections to it or any support in that, I think CPC would like to hear from the selectmen.
Okay.
Well, tomorrow night is the public hearing
right,
for the
yes.
Community Preservation Committee, and then I think the following week is when the Community Preservation Committee comes in and gives its report to the selectmen. So that'll be on February 1st, next Monday.
Okay. All right. So if we want to weigh in,
you can go directly to the source.
You're welcome.
Someone here needs to say that we want to have that we have some opinion we want to express.
That's right.
Or at least float it out here so we can decide. But I'm not sure whether we have an opinion necessary for the hearing process.
Well,
unless I'm wrong.
Well, we had a bunch of questions about the extent of our authority in this issue, and I realize what tradition has been. but it is a significant change from...
Wait, you're talking about Springsbrook Park?
I'm sorry, yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm talking about the hearing tomorrow night. The question is whether or not we want to wait. Do we want to deliver any message to the CPC tomorrow night during their hearing process?
About turf fields?
About turf fields. About the next field being Wilson Field.
I guess the only thing that I would say in general is that I am very concerned about a sense of inevitability, that once one starts down a path, that there's the presumption, that, of course, if you decided to start down that path, then of course you're going to go all the way down the path. And I'm not opposed to studying things or looking into it and getting prices, etc., but I think people should always understand that, okay, that's interesting, but that isn't anything that can be done now because we've got schools, we've got water pipes, and taxpayers have only so much space in their pockets. And while it's a very worthwhile cause, we may not be able to afford it right now.
The design, not the design.
Well, but that does beg the question, is there an approximate construction estimate for Wilson Field as a turf field with lights?
I think it's tentatively in the budget for $1 million.
$1 million, yeah.
That's, which sounds like a bargain, because what's the number for...
Which would make a 10% design fee.
But that's a complete, the Lilgren is a complete development of the property, whereas here this is taking a field that's...
Right.
Well,
currently,
complete development of one field.
Right. No, but what I understand, but has but tree removal and wetlands replication and everything.
But to Bill's point, I mean, whether it's...
Well,
I mean, it is a design, like some designs we get where it's a design that shouldn't change significantly over time. You could pay the $100,000 and have the design sitting there, and it's probably still reasonably useful even five or six years.
If that's not the case, then one...
Right, but I think as they're saying, you know, with the redevelopment of an existing big natural turf area to be overlaid as an artificial turf field, it's probably not a real complicated design over time unless we have shifts in the earth and water and things like that. But it does beg the question, and I mean, if we're going to pay $100,000 for design, is it because we're really prepared to pay $1 million to do the the field?
And I think that's what community preservation is hoping to get a sense of from the selectmen, which is, you know, how they feel about spending $100,000 of community preservation funds is entirely dependent upon whether or not we actually have the will to follow through to the final outcome of that design. And that would be a design for turf, for an artificial turf field. Mm-hmm. So
I have, if nothing else, I personally have real questions about the timing of this. We are under extraordinary demands for capital investment in this town right now, rebuilding infrastructure, schools, sewers, water pipes, and on and on.
Fire.
$8 million worth of capital projects on average being forecast every year for the next 6 years.
Well, I think the Fields Partnership and, you know, recreation and schools both are represented in there. I think, although I'm not prepared to speak for them, the increase in enrollment and the increase in kids that are playing sports is causing an extraordinary demand on the fields that are there. We have teams that are splitting fields. We have spring sports playing inside gyms. So although it might seem like a nice to have, it's the same reason we're you know, expanding Lane School and looking at other space needs studies all over town, is an increase in population and an increase in our athletic fields is an asset in town. And so I won't speak for them, but schools and recreation both are the knowledge base on that and both are in full support of needing that field and then what's to develop after that field. And so, you know, fields have to be developed on an ongoing basis, and there was $250,000 to fix drainage at B Field, which is the one field which made the most sense to the partnership if you were going to turf and you were going to light it. because of the infrastructure and the building and the kind of centralized campus area, so.
The other variable.
I would kind of beg to differ that it's just a nice to have. I completely understand how strained and everything that is in front of us, but I also think that there's some, you know, there's a lot of valid points from rec and schools, and they are the knowledge and struggling with what we have now. There's a lack of inventory, for sure.
I think the other variable is the Community Preservation Fund, which can't be used for most of the things that Bill was referencing, but is a savings account for this kind of project and wouldn't really have an impact on the individual taxpayer. You're making your deposit anyway. The problem is that unless that law is changed, the synthetic surface itself isn't eligible for funding from the Community Preservation Law. So politically, it's going to be harder to sell that project when it's time to build it unless the laws change.
Agreed.
It's interesting. CPA can pay for the design of a synthetic field, right, but not the field itself.
We can pay for everything up
under.
Until the surface.
No, I understand.
Right,
I know, so, yeah. We went through all this. Yeah. I mean, I'm just saying
it's
that it's kind of ironic that you can pay to design something you can't pay for.
The other problem, I sort of hate to bring it up because I'm not sure it's 100% true, but my understanding is the amount of monies that we have been collecting to replace the carpet on the Suburban Field have not begun to approach the projections that were made when we actually went down the path. And so I'm not saying it's not something that we don't need. I'm just saying it's probably something we can't afford right now. That's what I think it needs. So what I'm concerned is, if CPA, you're right, we collect that money, it's sitting there, it can be used for these purposes. It isn't going to change the amount of money that gets collected. But as I said, there tends to be this inevitability that if we study it or if we price it out, we're going to go ahead And if we go ahead immediately, I don't think we can afford to go ahead immediately.
I would agree with that, but I'd love to have the design sitting there if conditions were right for that, not have to go spend time with the design.
And I can tell you, and if you give me 2 seconds, which year in the community preservation plan
the construction
funds have been.
I thought it was 19.
Is it next year?
So the construction?
For the construction.
Fiscal year 17? Fiscal year 17?
18.
Yeah. You mean next year by all? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Look how hard I had to work to get this one done. And a lot of people are happy with just that.
Well, so we still have the question in front of us as to whether or not we want to weigh in at the CPC hearing, send our authorized representatives with some message.
I'm a member of the committee. I'll be there anyway.
Exactly.
So.
I just mean
you need to bring a message.
Is there an official message from us as to this particular design project?
The fact that we discussed this and that there were concerns expressed, at least by some, that this was the downside.
I don't sense unanimity at the moment.
No, I don't either.
I have no concern with going forward with the design money. So I don't know what anybody else thinks, but I have no concerns. So.
I mean, it's true that once you have the design, you're not committed to spend the money at any particular point.
Except that doesn't tend to be the attitude.
No, that's true. But if what you're saying is correct and that we can't afford it in the year which it comes into the budget, then, you know, that goes up before town meeting and we all have another opportunity to say whether or not we approve of the spending of the money at that time. And you could say that we approve of the design of an artificial turf field, the date of construction to be determined. If it comes up in a year when the numbers are going crazy, we can recommend disapproval, or we can recommend that it get put off a year.
And I think that the data isn't in front of us. We're talking, we've had studies and presentations put in front of us for everything but that field. And so the fact that I was just asked a day ago to get your support, you know, the Fields Partnership, I'm sure, would put together more data to tell you the need is there. So without that presentation or the opportunity for that presentation, I think it's a little premature to have any opinion either way.
Okay. Do we know how long the construction period for Lilligren is?
It's been 10 years.
I meant when the money's in hand and we're actually...
Did that come out loud?
My only concern is not really with the design, although, you know, set aside artificial turf.
Sure.
Overall. But my concern is going down the path of appropriating the money, hiring a designer, having the whole thing designed, and Lilligren is still not under construction.
Right.
Sure.
I think that would be a big problem. I want that project moving,
and I want it in the ground.
But that shouldn't be to the detriment. The need is there, and the longer Lilligren takes, the, you know, I mean, it's Wilson Field shouldn't be delayed. It should be second to it, and it should be after it, but that, I mean, that project is forever. I mean, I would like it to be sooner than forever, but it's been forever. And the need has been there for years, mm-hmm. since the ORASC group came in front of everybody, so.
I think it takes approximately a year mm-hmm. From the
scene as well.
Well, you seem to have a mixed bag here.
Yeah, so, I'll take that back to
them. You take that back, all right. Did you have anything else you wanted to
do? I'm done. See, I'm quiet
anybody
for a long time.
Anything,
you like it when I'm quiet.
Anything else you'd like to bring up?
I move we adjourn.
All right, then.
Watch out with those short agendas.
Been moved.
Someone seconded?
Mm-hmm. Second.
Moved and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstain. 5-0-0.